and we are glad that you are here. We are celebrating several things this morning, but one of the ones I want to tell you about quickly, but may do so again at the end of the service, is we're celebrating graduation. Yesterday was Bentonville High School's graduation. We had four young men from our congregation who were part of that celebration. One of them worships in this service. The cake and stuff is still going on in Becker Hall, so he's still over there at the moment, but I suspect he and his family will join us, and I want to introduce you to him. His name is Connor Klein. He's here almost every Sunday, and they sit in the back row, so you may not know who he is just because he stays very quiet back there. So we will celebrate that when he arrives. I invite you to begin our worship, and Judy is going to help us with our call.
Join me in our call of worship. How wondrous, a new heaven and a new earth. In its place, God will offer new hope and peace. Worship the Lord who is about to do a new thing. Join me in our opening prayer. Gracious and loving God, we are grateful that you have called us together this day, drawing us from the darkness to the glory of your light. May our spirits rejoice at the good news you have for us today. Open our hearts to the waters of your breathing love.
praise your holy name and give thanks for your greatness and all the gifts you give to us. And we offer back these, our gifts, Lord, to you in humble gratitude, that your good news may be spread throughout the land. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What is your name?
Cinco.
What a pretty name. Well, good morning. You know, a little bit, Pastor Griffith's going to be talking about flying animals. Have you ever heard of such a thing? You haven't? And one thing about them, the impossible can happen. So watch out, there may be flying animals. But today we're going to talk about Peter. Peter was a disciple. He saw some flying animals, sort of. Anyway, he was the disciple who denied knowing Jesus three times, but he was forgiven, and he went on to do great work in the church. But there were people criticizing Peter. They said he was hanging out with the wrong people. You see, those Jewish people had a lot of rules. They were really strict. They were telling who they could hang out with, what they could eat, what they could wear. And they thought Peter was disobeying. So Peter told them something about he had done. And he told them about a vision he had. And in this vision, animals came floating down from the sky. And he was told to eat those animals. And he said, no, that's against the rules. I can't eat those. But it happened two more times. It happened three times. Three is a special number with Peter. And he figured out what God was telling him. He was telling him that all people are acceptable and that we should love everyone and that God's word is for everyone. So, would you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for the amazing stories of the Bible. Thank you for helping us share your good news with others. Help us love one another. Thank you for Jesus. In his name. Thanks.
Thank you. That was special. It truly was. Before I start my message, there are several out there who do not know me, and maybe this might be your first time here at church, and so I wanted to explain. I'm the associate pastor. Our senior pastor, Reverend Jeanne, is traveling this weekend with her family to graduations. And how appropriate is that, because we are celebrating graduations here as well. And Chris, I don't see Connor. Did he go home? He's there. Good. All right. While I'm on the subject, we have a whole row of family back there that is awesome. And I would like, Connor, I'm not going to make you come forward again. We did that in the last service. Connor, if you would stand. Connor is faithful. He is in the back with his parents almost every week. He graduated from Bentonville High School just yesterday, and we are delighted that of all the exciting things that are ahead for him. And so we gave him a gift of a Bible and prayed over him in the last service, and so I won't make him stand any longer, so I'll let you sit down. So there's lots of celebrating going on in that family, in the Connor family. Thank you. Thank you guys for indulging me on that. Many of you may already know that I was born and raised in the state of Maryland. On the East Coast, for those of you who are geographically challenged, I tend to be. If people talk about states in the middle of the country, I have trouble remembering where those are, so you may be like me. Maryland's on the East Coast. It's very diverse geographically. In that yellow area are the Allegheny Mountains. And as you move toward the east, you come into more of an urban and a suburban area. That is where Baltimore and Washington, D.C. are. And as you move over into the dark orange, that's a very rural small towns, I mean, little itty-bitty towns, like 1,500 people, and farms, lots of rural activity there. And if you continue on south and then out further to the east, the Atlantic Ocean, Maryland borders on the edge of the Atlantic Ocean as well. So it goes from mountains to oceans, from urban areas to rural areas. It's a very, very diverse. And I'm sure you notice that right in the middle of it is the is a big blue area, and that is the Chesapeake Bay. It almost divides the state completely in half because it's so large and where it's located. Maryland is known for Maryland is known for many things. The Naval Academy is there. It's on the Chesapeake Bay. Annapolis is on the western edge of the Chesapeake Bay. It's also known for a couple of pretty good sports teams, the Ravens football team and the Orioles baseball team. You may not be aware that that there are some historical significance to Maryland, besides being one of the first 13 colonies. It also contributed two things to our heritage that are very significant. One is that it gave a little bit of its land for Washington, D.C., our nation's capital. You can see where that is, and it's just a little red dot there at the edge of Maryland. But the other is that the Star-Spangled Banner was written in Maryland during the War of 1812 by Francis Scott Key. So a couple of very significant contributions to our nation's heritage. So all of that said, if I were to tell you what is Maryland most noted for, I would have to say the seafood that you can get there. Seafood, of course, comes from that big bay and tributaries that are there. It is, I don't know, I forgot to Google it, if it's the number one economy in the state, but if it's not number one, it's very, very close to it. Watermen, mostly men, some are probably women, but mostly men, go out before the crack of dawn and catch fish and soft-shell clams and oysters, and the most famous that they catch is the blue crab, the Maryland blue crab. Maryland blue crabs come, you can see it's in the middle there, it is indeed blue. When you pull it out of the water, it's blue. They are caught, I had to show you some of this, just I hope you enjoy it, with unique boats. My grandfather was a waterman, and he had a boat just like that. You know what its name was? Anyway, very uniquely shaped boats because the crabs are caught in crab pots. You can see one up there in the corner. And you can see he's got a whole stack of crab pots on the top and at the back. So that roof that's flat is intentionally flat to put crab pots up there. Because they drop them over and they leave them for so long and the crabs crawl in and they can't get out. And that's how that works. They are brought to dock, to market, in those bushel baskets in the lower corner. And when the fishermen come in, the watermen come in, you can go and buy a bushel of crabs as an individual. They're also sold to restaurants, directly to restaurants, nice fresh seafood. And also they're sold to the seafood packing houses as well, right from the dock. We're not talking about some huge corporate approach to this, but each individual is their own business person, if you will. Now crabs, Maryland blue crab, how many of you have ever been to Maryland? A few, good. How many of you have ever eaten Maryland blue crab? Oh, a few less, but next time you go to Maryland, those who have been and those who have not, be sure you have some blue crab because it is outstanding. oftentimes get when they go to Maryland. I always get crap when I go home, and I'll tell you about my favorite here in a minute. It's served in a variety of ways. It's steamed. You can see the red things behind the bushel basket. Those are steamed crabs. They tend to be messy to eat. It takes a while, especially if you're not used to how to uncover the meat, which is under the shell. And so it takes a lot of the good luck because you spend more time picking the meat out than you do actually feeding yourself. But steamed crabs are delicious. If you don't like messy, don't go there. I don't go there, so I don't like messy. But crabs are made into crab cakes, which you also see down in the corner there. Crab imperial, crab dip, crab soup, stuffed crab shrimp. Just the list goes on and on and on. Now I have to say that my very favorite are the crab cakes. And I really encourage you to get crab cakes if you are ever in that area. In fact, sources say that more crab cakes are sold in the state of Maryland at restaurants than are hamburgers and hot dogs. And so that says a lot about how good crab cakes are. I hope you understand that. It's a different kind of menu, but one that can offer a new kind of excitement. And I hope you all get a chance to taste it sometime. And so it was for my husband, Bob. He and I started dating when we were in college. He was from New Jersey. His family had moved all over the country, but lived mostly in urban city areas and suburbs. He had only sisters. I had only brothers. And I had only lived in one place, a rural small town of about 1,200 people. And as I said, he lived all over the country, in Dallas, in Montana, in New Jersey. His dad worked in New York City. So we came from a totally different culture in our families. He came to visit me, but I looked like a promising young lady. So anyway, he came to visit me in the summertime, and he found out very quickly how different our families were. He also found out very quickly that my family was filled with jokesters and you needed to beware. The first thing that happened, not immediately that he walked through the door, but very quickly, we had a rocking chair in our living room that if he rocked too much, it would dump you out backwards. He sat in that chair. No one told him what that chair might do, and so needless to say, he went backwards into the floor. Very embarrassing situation for him, but he sustained himself through that. And then there were the five brothers. Remember, he has two very quiet, wonderful, gentle sisters. I had five brothers, very boisterous. Activities went on in my home when I was growing up. And Bob told me later he found it to be kind of like a locker room after a football game. So that's how things were. And then there was the food we ate. Now some of it he could relate to. We had a garden in our backyard, and so summer meals consisted of fresh tomatoes, fresh corn on the cob, fresh zucchini, fresh cucumbers in vinegar, and that was part of what we ate while he was there. He loved that. It was he didn't have the garden, but nevertheless he did like that. We had hamburgers and barbecue chicken, but we added to that crab cakes. He'd never had crab cakes before, but they did look good. And so he tried them and liked them. All was well. He started kind of settling into the family and how we did things there. And then someone put down in front of him but it looks a little different than what the crab meat for the crab cakes came out of. And he said, what is it? He said, it's a soft crab. And he said, what does that mean? And we explained that that means that the shell is no longer hard. It's part of the life cycle. They mold their hard shells and become soft. And we said, eat it. He said, how? And we said, well, here's a couple of pieces of bread and some butter. Put butter on the bread and put the crab in the middle and then just eat it like a sandwich. And he went, uh-huh. He told me later, he said, you know, I was sitting there thinking, this is another joke. They are trying to bait me into eating this hard, crunchy crab that they fried up just to pick on me, and I'm not doing it. And so he said very politely, no, thank you. And my oldest brother, who was sitting across the table from him, reached over and grabbed it and said, well, you're not going to eat it, I'm going to eat it. And he wolfed it down at that point. This truly is a delicacy in Maryland. It may not look like it to anyone who's never done this before, but it truly is a delicacy. And we had given him that honor by letting him have one. Mother only had just a couple of them. So one was for the guest. One was to help him. That was to help him get to know the family and things that we ate. And he was very distrustful and skeptical and said, no, thank you. And that is really kind of the atmosphere that was going on in the scripture we're going to read today. How often do we, and to the folks in the scripture, look at what is different and unexpected and countercultural to our own experiences in a way that causes us to even reject the notion and ignore or not even think about the possibilities of what might lie ahead? It is that kind of rejection that is in our scripture today. Acts 11, I'm going to read verses 1 through 18. This was Peter's report to the church at Jerusalem after ministering to the Gentiles. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers, also known as the Jews, criticized him, saying, why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them? So Peter had to explain himself. Then Peter began to explain it to them step by step, recounting everything that happened that led up to this. And he said, I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, get up, Peter, kill and eat. But I replied, by no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth. But a second time, the voice answered from heaven, what God has made clean, you must not call profane. This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up again to heaven, and at that very moment, were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and me. They were Gentiles, I was a Jew. And I lost my place. These six brothers, he pointed to disciples, also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. So he took six others with him to be his witnesses. He told us how, he being the man who came to us, told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, "Go to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I should hinder God? So the Jews who were listening heard this, and they were silenced. And they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus began his ministry with 12 selected men, all Jewish, all men who faithfully attended the synagogue, kept the Jewish laws of purity and the Jewish practices. But as his ministry grew, as the family of believers grew, it was no longer just Jewish men. It was men and women, adults and children. Judeans and Samaritans were included. The clean and the unclean, remember, he ministered to lepers. The slave and the free. And now, with Peter's ministry, Jews and Gentiles all are welcomed into God's family. Now realize for a second, if it hasn't occurred to you, that you and I and them, we're all Gentiles. Okay? You're either Jewish or you're Gentile. Now, some of you may have Jewish heritage in your background, but if you do, it's probably a very small number. So, had Peter's ministry never happened, we wouldn't be sitting here today. Now, God might have found another way, but nevertheless, this is when people like you and me were included in God's family. Peter explained to those who were listening what exactly had happened. And the man could have said, "I'm sorry, we've never done that before." And that would have been the end of it, at least for that moment on. But just as Peter relates in his account, it was very clear that was not his doing. It was the hand of God that was involved in that story. The vision that Peter had, the angel that appeared to the Gentile, and how the two were brought together because of what they were told. God's hand was involved in this. And Peter said, "When God's hand's involved, how dare I get in the middle of that? I am not going to hinder the spread of the kingdom." Peter was saying God's family is not defined by where we grew up, by what we eat, by our cultural practices, by our gender, by our sexual orientation, but instead, God's family is defined by and grows by the transforming love of God through the Holy Spirit that enters our hearts. We are clean, not because of what we eat, where we live, whether we take a shower or not, but the kind of clean I'm talking about is because of the love that we have in our hearts. We are unclean when we harbor hardness in our hearts. It is the changed hearts that we have, changed by the Holy Spirit, that make us clean, that call us to be part of God's family, and that cause God's kingdom to come to earth. Now, as that dating happened back in many, many years ago in Maryland, our family has grown. And it's grown through love. Jesus said, and this was read this morning by Jill, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." Our family has grown. We have broken down cultural barriers. And we now have, that's not all the family up there, but it's a good portion of it. We've grown through children arriving, through marriages, through friendships, through partnerships. The family members now consist of folks who were raised all over the United States with different habits and different tastes and different backgrounds. But nevertheless, the family has grown in the spirit of love and acceptance which Christ called us to share. And so has the Christian family grown through that spirit of love and acceptance which we are called to share. Jesus said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." All nations. In this picture, we see Asians and Africans and Latinos and Caucasians all sharing the love and acceptance which Christ commanded and modeled for us. We are a global community now, and still growing, thankfully. The kingdom of God has spread and is spreading around the world. Not because we're from the same background, same culture, same eating practices and habits, but through the gift of God's love as shared through the Holy Spirit in the hearts of believers. Do we, as believers, put God in a box? How often do we think that God is confined to a certain set of rules and practices? We see God is confined to certain cultural norms and eating habits. And then one day, God jumps out of that box and says, "Surprise! It's not just you Jewish people. It's the Gentiles, too." Or, "Surprise! It's not just people in the U.S. and Europe. It's people all over the world that are a part of my family." You are not unclean by what you eat. You are unclean by hardness that is in your heart. It's about the love that you share with others, not just those who are like you, but most especially with those who are not like you. All are my children. And how dare you hinder and and stand in the way of my kingdom coming to earth. I have given them my Holy Spirit and have welcomed them into my family. Do not forbid them. That is how my family grows. That is how my kingdom comes to earth as it is in heaven. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, the beauty of the diversity of your creation is beyond belief. It is majestic. Forgive us when in our human condition we make idols of our own culture, our own habits, our backgrounds, and our beliefs. Forgive us, Lord, when we stand in the way of others seeing you because of our biases. Help us see, Lord, that our hardness of heart is the cause of us being the roadblock. Bless us with a new heart for your love, a new understanding that your love extends to all, and a new mission to share that love with others, especially those who are different from us. Lord, this morning, we ask for your healing blessing on all those who mourn. And we especially ask for your blessing on the family of Clarence Merrill. We have a white carnation on our altar in memory of Clarence. And we ask for your blessings on the family of Jeremy Schaffman in the loss of his sister, Kathy. Lord, we ask for your blessings, your love to be on those who are recovering from surgery and hospitalization, and those who are still hospitalized. And this morning we especially ask for blessings on Dick Anderson, Ed Jenner, Michelle Force, Chet Campbell, Chuck Eldridge, and Reagan Whitaker. Lord, we give you thanks for your loving blessings on Beverly Puma and her family as they settle into their new home after suffering through a devastating fire which took their previous home. Lord, surprise us this day with the majesty of your love and with the inclusiveness that extends that love to all of your creation. It is in your name we pray. Thank you, Casey. Much better. You can't hear me reading anymore. Your invitation to Christian discipleship this morning is to extend the love of God to someone who's different than you. Don't say I've never done that before. Just do it through the love of the Holy Spirit. There is one way that you can do that. You can contribute to Mountain of Food, which is accumulating, and you can see a picture of that out in the hall on the way to Beck Hall. You can extend a kind word or a smile to someone that you ordinarily wouldn't have done that to. That shares the good news. That tells the story of who Christ is, and who Christ and what Christ came for us to know. And so as we conclude this worship service this morning, I invite you to stand as you are able and join together in We've a Story to Tell to the Nations. It's number 569 in your hymn. come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. I'm currently reading a book called Simply Jesus. It's by N.T. Wright, who also wrote Simple Christianity. And his premise in that book is that God's kingdom will come to earth when all of our hearts are transformed. May it be so. Take that good news of God's kingdom of love and light into the world so that hearts can be transformed. Go in peace.